Alright, welcome back to the channel, guys. This is a video that I wanted to get out for a while now, and I've talked about it in the comment section a couple times, but it is going to be the top 10 most underrated cards in Edison format, in my opinion. These are just some cards that I noticed that need a little bit more respect, and yeah, let's just hop right into it. Okay, so the first one is actually Blackwing Board of Spirit. Now, don't get me wrong, this is actually the worst Blackwing monster in the Blackwing deck. That is not up for debate. Like, he is the worst Blackwing. You couldn't put this card over Blizzard. You would never say this card is better than Shora. You definitely wouldn't say it's better than Gale. So it's not really better than any of them. Vayu has an entire deck named after it, so that can just speak for itself. But yeah, this is the worst Blackwing in the deck. However, Blackwings are just so good that Bora, despite the fact that he has a weird attack stat, and that's pretty much all he does is Pierce, he is relevant in the sense that attacking face down monsters doesn't really feel good when you're not being rewarded for doing so. And this guy gives you a tremendous reward for attacking face down monsters, especially when you put him together with Sirocco. 3,700 is nothing to scoff at. It's usually more than half of people's life points if you have a Kalute or a Gale on top of it. So yeah, it's kind of ridiculous that in one attack, you can take half of someone's life points. Even just doing Sirocco Bora into a face down Raikou, right? Like, just 3,700 into a face down Raikou, which is the most common set monster in the format. Raikou is the most common thing that you will run into when you attack a face down monster. And that is a straight up 3,600 from your opponent's life points off the bat. So you put them at almost half life for basically just breathing. And that is, yeah, that's insane. I also like the fact that he's a 4-star monster. I think that is a big deal too for Blizzard purposes. You just kind of need your Blizzards to be live as fast as possible. So at the very least, if your Bora doesn't get to do some crazy piercing damage with Sirocco or whatever, you can use him to just make a level 6 synchro. He's also a monster that you can special summon once you have a Blackwing, of course. So sometimes you can just flood the field and attack for a lot. Blackwings do win by damage. It's like their main win condition. And I'm not memeing when I say that. I think Blackwings is the deck that, out of all the other decks, I feel like you're just on a clock. It is scary how quickly this deck can end games. And it just makes you feel like you're always being pressured. Bora helps with that. And I want to also put Armed Wing in this conversation as well. So yeah, Bora is the one that's mostly slept on. Armwing, I don't think people realize that 2,800 attacking defense monsters and piercing at the same time is a bit ridiculous. Like, it's actually just a win condition in so many scenarios. There were games where I literally was down so many cards and my opponent is playing like a deck like Quick Draw, and they just have a token or a Raikou or something stupid on the field, and they might have a Titanial next to it and a Stardust and all this other stuff, and I just draw Blizzard, make Armwing and attack their token for 2,800, and it's just game. So there's a lot of that type of thing that can happen in Edison format where you steal games because of the just piercing damage is so real. Next up is Gold Sark. Now, in Edison format, I think this card is actually really, really good for multiple reasons. One of the main reasons is that in Edison format, you always get two turns. You're always going to get two turns. There has to be an absolute disaster if you don't get two turns in Edison format. So as long as you see this card in your opening hand, you will typically get to see whatever you searched. And that is really good, because if you look at my top 10 most problematic cards, those are the cards that people usually are Gold Sarking for. Dark Arm Dragon, Brain Control, stuff like that. Like, really, really, really powerful cards. And it makes sense, because the decks that play Gold Sarcophagus, and this is being explored more, but the decks that play Gold Sarcophagus tend to have a problem where they play either many engines or they just play a deck that isn't as powerful without seeing a specific card. Think about Dragons. Dragons, if it sees Future Fusion, is one of the best decks in the format. If it doesn't see Future Fusion, it's very mid. So Dragons always play this card. It actually just got second place at Deck Devastators. I'm pretty sure this card was in its deck. It makes sense. Future Fusion is one of the best cards, period. And then on top of that, in Dragons, it is the best that it could possibly be. So Gold Sark being able to get to this card is really good. It's also really good in Diva Hero. And this is something that I talked to a true hero about before Deck Devastators 3. And like, he took Gold Sark out of his deck at one point, and we were play, and I just didn't feel intimidated by the Diva Hero deck anymore. And I remember we had a session that he wanted to play test before RBET Rulers, because he qualified for RBET Rulers. So we were play testing for that. And the games where he drew Gold Sark, I was just getting bodied. Like, absolutely bodied. It was like, Sark for Brain Control, Sark for Dark Arm Dragon, Sark for Heavy Storm, Sark for Return from Different Dimension. And it was just ruining me. That deck needs to draw different parts of its engine. So it needs to draw water monsters, it needs to draw hero monsters, and it also needs to draw Miracle Fusions. This card, Gold Sark, kind of bridges the gap between all of those different things. And the same can be said about other decks like Monarchs. I feel like the Monarch deck also has the issue where you could have Treeborn Frog coming back every turn and, you know, your dupe block and all that stuff. But at the end of the day, if you don't have Monarchs or something to do with your advantage, it just kind of, you just kind of like waste turns passing with monsters, like little guys on the field. Whereas Gold Sark can guarantee you your Miracle Fusion if you play the Junk Hero Frog deck, or a guaranteed Caius. And that's just really, really good. It's very, very good. Also, obviously, Sarking for Brain Control, again, the most problematic card in the format. That is insane. But yeah, I'm noticing that this card is being played in a lot more decks than just Dragons. And that's good. It's played, obviously, in Lightsworn decks and Christia Sworn, stuff like that. I think this card might be able to be played in more than just those decks. And that is good that people are starting to notice that, because you do get the time to actually get the card you looked for. Next on the list is Mind Control. I don't think this card is respected enough. I think that Mind Control just deserves a lot more respect. Brain Control is ridiculous, mainly because you can attack. I get it, and you contribute to monster and stuff like that. But Mind Control steals face down cards. And it's super weird to me that Blackwing decks, especially hybrid Blackwing decks, don't play this card a lot of the time, because that deck plays 3 Vayue, 3 Blizzard, and a Gale. So that's 7 tuners right there. I just can't imagine not playing it in a deck with 7 tuners. Even if the Vayus aren't technically always a real tuner, but like between Sliding Skill Drain, Shore's actual effect, the Summon Value, and Negate its effect, that way you can get some really good value off of Mind Control. And that's not the only deck. Like, you notice that the Fairy decks are all playing, ever since Pro Storm 1, RBET Rulers, all Fairy decks are playing one copy of Cyber Valley, and Mind Control is absolutely busted with that card. I think stealing face down Hamsters and Rekkos is also ridiculous. It just really ruins your opponent, because setting monsters usually feels very safe, and Mind Control is one of the only ways that doesn't feel safe. It can also do the annoying thing that Brain Control kind of does, where you don't lose to anything except them stealing your monster and attacking you directly. And so sometimes you'll be at pretty low life points and your opponent will just Mind Control you and attack with something. And it's just like, yeah, that's actually game. I didn't see that coming. I couldn't stop that. So Mind Control is really, really good. And I think that it should just be played more. So that's kind of why it's on my underrated cards list. I think that this card is just not played as much as it should be. Okay. Compulsory Evacuation Device. I don't have too much to say about this, except the fact that it is one of the easiest pieces of removal in the format. A lot of decks that go into their extra deck too much, I would say decks like Diva Hero, Zombies, stuff like that, they're very susceptible to Compulse being good against them. It doesn't care about Stardust Dragon. It pretty much doesn't care about anything except Thought Ruler Archfiend, which people don't summon that much. And I don't think anyone really plays around Compulse anyway. If anything, if someone summons a Thought Ruler Archfiend, the thought was that they were playing around D Prison. But people usually don't see Compulse coming. And the fact that it's chainable, that's the part that makes this card so good, is that it's chainable. Whereas D Prison, you do have to wait for your opponent to attack. And some people in certain situations are like, I don't have to attack here, I can just wait. And that can be really, really annoying when you don't want your opponent to wait until they draw Heavy Storm now, or wait until they get Royal Decree or MST or Dust Tornado or something like that, because they know, they kind of have a feeling that you have Deep Prison based on the way you're playing and just deck lists being common and stuff like that. But Compulse can just completely get around that. So I really like this card. Also, it can be used on your own monsters, and that is valuable too. So when you go to summon a Shura or something and your opponent goes bottomless and you're like, fuck that, I want my Shura, I'm just going to Compulse it back to my hand. One of my favorite things is summoning Blizzard, using Blizzard's effect, bringing back a guy, and then when they go to attack Blizzard on the next turn, let's say I didn't synchro with the Blizzard and the monster I brought back, they go to attack, and then I just Compulse back the Blizzard, and now I can just reuse it. That comes up sometimes, especially if you have, like, the most common thing is that you summon Blizzard, you bring back a guy, and then you have Icarus attack, so you kind of want the plus one there, where you get to use Icarus in a way for free. And then you also have Compulse, you can just bounce the Blizzard back and keep that advantage going. So yeah, Compulse is really, really good. It's an answer to established boards, whereas bottomless trap hole is terrible. After you draw it against an established board, Royal Oppression is terrible. Torrential is terrible. All of these cards are terrible if you draw them against an established board. But Compulse is really good against established boards. It deals with extra deck cards really easily. And yeah, I really like that it can be a plus one depending on how your opponent went into their extra deck. So it's one of the easiest ways to deal with things. Next is My Body as a Shield. This one is rising in popularity now. My Body as a Shield is really good right now because of Deck Devastation Virus and Icarus Attack and Bottomless Trap Hole being very, very commonly seen cards in the format. I think the decks that get actually devastated by Deck Devastation Virus all need to be playing this card somewhere because it's the only way you can really stop it on the fly. The weird part is there is counterplay to it. If your opponent knows that you might be on My Body as a Shield, if they start to realize that this is becoming more common, they could deck dev you before you have a guy on the field, because then you can't even play My Body as a Shield on Deck Devastation Virus. But if your opponent isn't aware of that and they let you bring back like Treeborn Frog, for example, and they wait too long, then you can actually use My Body as a Shield. But yeah, decks like Fairies and Plants and Frog decks, they all probably should be playing My Body as a Shield somewhere, just to have a chance to not get absolutely ruined by Deck Devastation Virus, because that card really is game against those decks when it resolves. So barring a insanely lucky thing where you're like, oh, I have exactly four fairies and my last card in hand or my only cards in hand are Christie's or something, like that's the only time when Deck Devy could be a bad thing. But for the most part, it's an auto win. And there's a really, really crazy clip that I saw from Deck Devastators 3. In fact, I'm the one who clipped it. But it is Ronak playing with the Frog Fairy deck, and I think that he got devastated for 8 total cards in one turn. So Deck Devy took 8 of his cards in one turn, and that is just not okay. He had 10 cards, and he went down to 2, and I think on his next draw phase, another card got destroyed. So yeah, it took so many of his cards, and that's just not okay. But yeah, My Body as a Shield, you know, it's really good against Icarus Attack, as I already said. It's also a plus one in that situation. I guess it's also good to talk about it in terms of Gemini Spark and Absolute Zero. It stops those from destroying your monsters or cards as well, depending on what the situation is. But yeah, it's a pretty decent card. So I just wanted to bring this one up as well. Enemy Controller, I think, is underrated, especially now that Zombie decks, Diva Hero decks, and Frog decks all play these really, really cool tuner monsters that literally bring out another guy in some way, and they pair so well with Econ. Not to mention what it does for the Frog decks. That's like the most obvious thing. Everyone knows that Frog Monarchs can just play Enemy Controller, and it's standby phase, bring back Treeborn, tribute with Enemy Controller, take your guy, then bring back Treeborn again, and then I can still do more plays after that. That's like the most basic thing, but I think that what Nazar does in his zombie deck with Diva, summon Diva, like Diva effect to get another Diva, and then you Enemy Controller take their monster and then synchro with their monster, it's kind of just another copy of Brain Control at that point, right? Like there's no real difference between that and Brain Control when you do it. So that is a really, really broken interaction. A monster can attack, it can be tributed, it can be synced with, there's no restrictions on it like Mind Control. But yeah, Enemy Controller, it's pretty underrated. I don't really see it played that much, and it randomly has another effect where you can put a guy in defense mode. And that might matter as well, depending on, you know, the situation. Like Monarchs all have 1,000 defense. I like to use those as an example a lot of time, because 1,000 is really easy to beat over. So if you have something like Shura or Full Helm Knight, they get additional value from that. Or just beating over it with a Fossil Dyna is really good. And yeah, Enemy Controller is a slept on card. Okay, next is Battle Fader. This card is, I think it's better than what I originally thought, so that's why I'm putting it on an overrated list. I just didn't expect it to be. It's kind of broken, actually. And so the main decks that played are Chaos decks and Frog decks. And it does something like no other in-hand monster. It like Gores and Trigoti require that you actually do take damage. And sometimes that is just not in the cards. Like you can't take the next attack, so you just lose the game with Gores and Trigoti in your hand. Or it's kind of awkward to drop them at the time for whatever reason. But Battle Fader not only stops the entire attack, you take zero damage, but it ends the battle phase. And I was playing against Glad Beast, and I was running the Frog deck. And I've been playing Frogs for like the last month, and I'm really, really enjoying the deck. And so it gave me an opportunity to try out Battle Fader in Edison format. Up until that point, I had never played it in the entire year that I've been playing Edison. So like up until, I guess, January 2023, I hadn't played Battle Fader in a single thing. And I was playing against Sean McCabe, actually, and he went to attack me with two Glad Beasts, and I Battle Fadered it. And not only did it end his battle phase and, you know, prevent him from tagging out completely, but then obviously I was able to tribute the Battle Fader on the very next turn for Akaius and banish his guy, tech over the other one. It was a really, really good situation. And I really like the card for that reason. It also is good against decks that just want to OTK you, so zombies and D.Va Hero and stuff like that. It just makes you feel safe. I like playing those decks that don't play real traps or whatever. And when you have Battle Fader, you just feel like no matter what my opponent does outside of summoning Vanity's Fiend, Cristia, Falsandina, or having Royal Oppression set, I am guaranteed getting another turn in this game, right? So seeing another turn when you're playing a deck that does require a bit of a slower grind, like the Monarch decks and the Chaos Fairy deck, stuff like that, it makes sense that this card is really good for those strategies that don't play a lot of natural defense in the back row. They just kind of keep it in their hand. The other thing is that it combos really, really well with Dimensional Alchemist, and that can be understated as well. Dimensional Alchemist can kind of loop this, you know, you have Alchemist get destroyed and then you get your Battle Fader back and now your opponent can't kill you again. So it's really obnoxious when that happens. But yeah, this card is just pretty slept on. It's also randomly a Dark Fiend, so it has good typing. It's a 1-star monster. It's 0/0. So there are things that can be done with Battle Fader outside of all the stuff that I've mentioned. But yeah, at the very least, just ending the battle phase completely, taking zero damage and getting another turn, that's actually pretty valuable. Okay, Skill Drain. Skill Drain I don't really see outside of, I guess the only times it's really played is when Blackwing sometimes side it and Hero B decks tend to main it sometimes, I guess. I think it's the only times I ever see this card, but it's really, really good in my opinion. Oftentimes when my opponent has Skill Drain, it just changes the entire way you have to play the game, and not in a pleasant way because your deck is most likely not going to be built for it. I think it's really, really strong in the Blackwing side deck because people saw Consecrated Lights, and this deals with that really well on top of dealing with things like the Monarch deck. It makes their deck not good. It deals with Hamsters and Rykos and the Breed Dragons and all of the things that just kind of give Blackwing's problems. It deals with all of them. So Skill Drain is really, really good. I think that more Blackwing players should be side decking this card. I do see it in some of them, but sometimes I don't. And I don't know. I just think that it should be played more. It's a pretty good one. I also like it in Hero Stun. I think it's best in Hero Stun when you play like Beast King Barbaros and a bunch of aliases. Because if I don't have effects, then you shouldn't either. Like Alias is just a vanilla at the end of the day, but it's an engine because it empowers your Gemini Sparks and your Hero Blast. So when you have Skill Drain, it's like, well, now my 1900 vanilla is relevant. And this card, thank God it's at 2, because I just don't want to play in a world where it's at 3 and you have to expect it like 40% of your games. And yeah, it's just a really, really obnoxious card, but it's not played as much. It's pretty slept on in my opinion. All right, next is Zombie World. I didn't know how cracked this card was when it came to decks that play machine monsters predominantly. So that new Machina Control deck, I don't really know what the name of that deck is, but it plays like Hamsters and Rykos and Kaiuses. And then it just has a ton of machines in it as well. Like 3 Gear Frame, 3 Fortress, 2 Machina Force, Car Trooper, stuff like that. That deck is actually really, really, really good. And I saw that one of the people who topped Deck Devastators 3 was siding Zombie Worlds. And at first I was like, oh yeah, this is good because it stops your opponent from summoning Monarchs. So it's really good. It's better than Mask of Restrict in that regard because it turns everything into like a zombie. But where it really shines is that your opponent can't Cyber Dragon you. They can't contact with your field. And that is crazy. So on top of it being Mask of Restrict and theoretically searchable because it's a field spell, so you could theoretically play Terraforming as well if you wanted to be like hardcore. But even still, even if you just draw it raw, it stops them from summoning any Monarchs, and it also completely shuts down what people do to counter machine decks, which is side Cyber Dragon. Almost every single person who plays Edison format sides or main Cyber Dragon, and the goal is to contact, if not just, you know, beat over something, but usually it's the contact, and if you're playing machines, that's what they're going for. So this shuts that down while also shutting down the Monarch deck, and I think that is really, really, really good. It also randomly can be good against the Fairy deck because they can't summon Cristia. So if I were playing against something like the Cristia Lightsworn deck or whatever, and I don't have much else to side, I think I would put this in because Cristia is a really big problem. and all the monsters in the graveyard become zombies, so they will never have four fairies as long as this is face up. So that's really, really good there too. But again, the main thing is that it's good against the Monarchs for multiple reasons, because the cyber dragons that they put in and not being able to summon Kaius against you or Ryze or whatever is really strong. Okay, number one. So again, this isn't in any particular order, but I did want to save oppression for last regardless. So the reason why is because this card lately has been slept on and kind of shitted on in a lot of other people's content, or just the way people talk and discords and stuff. And I think that people are forgetting how ridiculous this card actually is. Like, it's on my, it's funny, Royal Oppression's on my most problematic cards list. It's on my most underrated cards list. And spoiler alert, it's on my most overrated cards list as well. It's on all three lists, but it's on all of them for very different reasons. So the reason why it's on the underrated list is because right now, if you look at the decks that are doing well, all of them special summon a shit ton. And that is like their main way of winning. So you look at like Diva Hero and the Machina deck, they all kind of special summon a lot, like Lightsworn decks and Christia Sworn, and even the new Frog decks, the new Frog Junk Monarch decks, they special summon a lot. I've been playing the deck for a while, and I've noticed that I'm often afraid that my opponent might have Royal Oppression when I'm going to make a play, because if they have it, it's actually going to end my turn. So if you need to summon the Evil Hero Infernal Prodigy guy, that can be oppressed. Junk Synchron can be oppressed. One for One, Substitute, Special Summon Swap Frog, Miracle Fusion. These are all things that get stopped. Battle Fader, all these things get stopped by Royal Oppression. So a deck that normally, like way back in the day, you couldn't really use Royal Oppression against Monarch decks, but they've evolved to a point where they are relevant for 2023 and 2022 Edison, and it's good. Like, don't get me wrong, I love the way the newer Frog decks are played and built, but they are way more susceptible to Royal Oppression than they've ever been. And there are some times where this card will just absolutely end the game by itself. It kind of has that same feeling as Dushoot often, where, like, you know, you Dushoot someone and it turns into a non-game and they can't possibly do anything because you know all of their cards, so the game typically just falls apart. Oppression is one of those cards where when it's good, it's too good, just like Dushoot. It's like, holy shit, you drew it on turn one. And Oppression is one of those cards where when it's good, it's like, okay, if I don't have an out to this, I might flat out lose because it's there. And it's really, really annoying when that happens. So I just think that people forgot how good Oppression is, and I just want people to put respect on it. I think that this card should be respected a bit more. I get that, you know, people side Dust Tornadoes and Twister and Decree and all of that stuff, but at the end of the day, you still have to have those cards when Oppression gets flipped. And I don't think that part is talked about enough. Like, sure, you are siding for a back row anyway, but if you don't draw one of your back row hating cards at the right time, Oppression is going to plus one on you instantly. Like, you go summon Infernal Prodigy and they Oppression and you don't have MST right there. You just lost your Infernal Prodigy, so your opponent's just plus one because the Oppression's still there and you're down a card. And then later on when you get rid of it, like, it Oppression might end up being taking more of your cards than just, you know, the one that it negated. So this card, super slept on, super underrated right now, and super problematic. And when I put it on the overrated list, you'll hear why I think it's also overrated, because it's kind of funny. The three different reasons why it's on three different lists of cards. But yeah, Oppression is, it's just actually still really good. And I think that more people should be playing it, but what are you going to do? Anyways, I hope you guys enjoyed this video and I will catch you in the next one. Peace out.